Hi everyone. So we're going to kick off the afternoon by talking on who and who is not a terrorist and describing how you can prescribe these organizations. So we've got Lee Jarvis to start things off. He's a reader from University of East Anglia, and he'll be followed by Richard, who's the director of research at Trends. So it's all over to you, Lee.
Thank you. Excellent. Okay, and thank you to Richard and everyone at ICSR and Trends for inviting me and for having me here, and thank you for your time and attention. So what I wanted to do in my talk was to say a little bit about some work I've been doing with a colleague of mine, Tim Legrand, at the Australian National University, and some work around the theme of prescription as a counterterrorism technique, particularly in the United Kingdom's context. And I hope in my talk to speak to three different themes that have already been touched upon this morning. Firstly, the politics of naming and labelling terrorist groups. Secondly, the role of different branches of government within the politics of counterterrorism, the role that different aspects of government have vis-a-vis the executive. And then thirdly, I guess with Harmony's talk in particular, the different terrains upon which terrorist violences and counterterrorism might be discussed and debated. So when I talk about prescription, I'm talking effectively about the banning or the outlawing of particular organisations from a designated territory. Prescription, I think, is a really interesting power. It's got roots going back hundreds of years, arguably thousands of years, the banning of enemies of the state from a particular polity. And it's a power that's widely used around the globe for counter-terrorism purposes in particular, but not only for those purposes. In the United Kingdom, the power to prescribe ultimately lies with the Home Secretary, who can bring forward an organisation to Parliament who must debate an order but can't amend it, along this set of criteria here, all set out within the Terrorism Act 2000. The consequences of prescription, I think, are really significant. They carry, in the UK at least, a range of they trigger a range of offences. They carry a range of punishments, from significant fines to prison sentences and that kind of thing. Anjem Chowdhury's recent conviction, for example, was for inviting support for a prescribed organisation, in that case, the Islamic State. One of the things that's interesting, I guess, is that this is a power that's being used increasingly. So in the UK at the moment, you've got 84 different organisations that are banned under the Terrorism Act or under earlier legislation in the context of Northern Ireland, and eight of those groups have been added in the last couple of years alone. And just by some way of comparison, that compares with, I think, 60 foreign terrorist organisations that are banned in the United States, 54 in Canada and 20 in Australia. Now, as an academic working in this area, one of the things that really interests me is that given prescription is fairly significant in terms of the offences that it brings on, given that this power is one that's widely used around the world and has been used for hundreds of years, and given the amount of academic ink that's spilt around counterterrorism more generally, there's really, really little academic literature on this particular type of counterterrorism policy. What there is tends to be written by people writing from a background in law, and tends to be organised around these two big questions of ethics and efficacy. So firstly, is this a legitimate way of engaging in counterterrorism activities, given that it might have implications for human rights and so forth? The second question, does prescription work? Is this a useful or an effective way of countering the terrorist threat? The academic work tends to emphasise the contingency of prescription decisions, that in some senses a judgment has to be made by someone in the context of banning particular organisations. What my work with Tim Legrand has been trying to do is to shift that debate a little bit and to ask a different set of questions around effectively how and under what circumstances politicians debate whether or not to add new organisations to the list of banned groups. So how do parliamentarians in particular debate whether or not it's appropriate to ban Boko Haram or the Islamic State or whoever is being brought forward by the Home Secretary at that time? And the argument that we've been trying to make so far from this research is, I guess, there are three claims that we've made to date. Firstly, that when politicians debate whether or not to add new organisations to the list of banned groups, they're engaging in a process of identity formation, that this is part of a differentiation of the national self-identity from the kind of illiberal terrorist others that are out there. Secondly, that these political debates have some kind of a ritualistic quality, that what is going on here is not just a process of decision-making, do we ban Boko Haram or not, but there is also, and perhaps more importantly, going on in these debates, a performance of democracy and a performance of sovereignty. And yet, the third argument we're making in the work on this theme today is that despite that ritualistic aspect to these debates, they're not shorn of politics, that there are many examples of specific politicians or legislators making demands upon the executive within them, asking the executive to justify or explain why it feels the banning of these organisations is appropriate in a particular context or at a particular time, and so forth. The paper that I'm presenting at the moment is really the last aspect of this part of the project, and there are three questions that I'm really keen to look at in the remainder of my presentation. Firstly, how do politicians talk about prescription as a form of counter-terrorism power? Secondly, what kinds of value are attributed to this power by politicians, and what are the critiques that come forward within parliamentary debates themselves, and how does that speak to the kind of questions we've been looking at already today? And then thirdly, why might we care? Why might these things matter at all? So, to begin with that first question about the framing of prescription powers, one of the things that's really interesting, I've spent an indecent amount of time trawling through Hansard debates now, looking at how these things are spoken about. And one of the things that is really clear is that they follow a very formulaic pattern in some respects. That they have a very standard opening where the Home Secretary or someone on their behalf comes forward to Parliament and outlines what prescription is, where the power comes from, what the consequences of adding a particular organisation to the list involve, and what kind of criteria have been employed to make that decision. You get a series, these debates are full of reference to the significance of prescription, that this is a really important task that we as politicians, we as the legislature are engaged with, that it matters whether or not we add these organisations to the list, and it matters that we follow due process and so forth. The debates are full of references to the appropriateness of prescription as a form of counter-terrorism technique. Hazel Blair, in 2005, described it as a useful power, and that kind of framing is fairly common. And you get lots and lots of discussion about the process of banning organisations within very, very stereotypical liberal democratic language, that this is a process that is impartial, that is transparent, that is conducted according to a set of established conventions and so forth, and that members of the House of Parliament need to be taking those things seriously. And as we might expect, when this power is being discussed, you get lots and lots of reference to the value that prescription might pose specifically for confronting terrorist organisations. And the argument that basically runs through all of these debates from 2002 onwards, so 2002 being the first one that followed the passage of the 2000 Terrorism Act, the argument you get running through all of these debates is that prescription serves multiple counter-terrorist functions. And sometimes they're lumped together, in West's example, other times they're outlined more specifically, that the banning of terrorist organisations can have a role in disrupting, preventing and deterring terrorist organisations. It's an argument that comes through fairly frequently. But that this power also has an important symbolic or communicative role too. That prescription banning groups is at least in part about expressing the UK's opposition to terrorism, but also potentially about expressing support for the United Kingdom's international allies as well. That it serves multiple kind of symbolic purposes. And yet, despite that kind of value, despite these multiple functions that prescription is said to serve, in the UK context at least, parliamentary debate in this area is really interesting because it's full of criticisms as well of this power. There are lots and lots of challenges that are put forward or questions that are put forward about its value in general or in specific cases. So a very common set of questions, challenges, critics, is about its effectiveness. Does prescribing organisations work in terms of making us more secure from terrorism? And debate in this area tends to go along the lines of, well, contemporary terrorist organisations are fluid and they change their name and that kind of thing. So how is this going to improve our security from terrorism? You get arguments being raised that prescription might be counterproductive, that it might be seen as a badge of honour for terrorist groups, encouraging people to enlist with particular organisations, same kind of argument you see with ASBOs. Or more seriously, that it might deter organisations from pursuing kind of more peaceful approaches to conflict resolution, that banning organisations puts dialogue off of the table effectively. These debates are replete with civil liberty concerns, that prescription is often argued by members of the British political establishment as having really problematic consequences for things like freedoms of association, freedoms of speech, for rights to resist opposition at home and abroad, those kind of things. And there are a whole series of concerns that are raised in these debates about the banning of organisations, implications for democracy more broadly. And the argument that is often raised here is that perhaps the United Kingdom's list of banned organisations serves the interests of other powers in the international system more than its own. So the question, or the kind of the final part of my presentation is basically, so what? So what do we make of these debates and their importance? And I guess I wanted to finish by pointing to three arguments and a question, and the paper is still very much under construction. The first argument that we try and make in the paper is that these debates share a fairly standard and a fairly formulaic discursive framework, that they're organised typically around a fairly standard and perhaps a predictable semantic structure in which positive things about the United Kingdom, parliamentarians of parliament are emphasised, and the organisations that are being banned or outlawed are spoken about in very characteristically negative terms. And that discursive framework is also one that we see saturated with particular types of rhetorical tropes. So similar kinds of metaphors come up within these debates, that those advocating the banning of organisations talk about metaphors of balance, those opposing adding new groups to these organisations use different kinds of discursive resources. So that's the first argument, that there is something of a particular discursive framework within these debates. The paper's second argument is that these debates themselves position prescription as something that matters. They're not a reflection of the importance of this counter-terrorism technique. They're a way of performing its importance. And you get this by advocates and opponents of prescription alike, that people that speak within these debates generally make the argument that prescription matters, maybe because of national security reasons, maybe because of civil liberty concerns, and maybe for other reasons still. And yet there's a paradox there, in that what goes on within much of these debates is not a specific playing through of the merits of banning a particular organisation at a particular moment. What tends to happen is that these debates are instrumentalised by politicians to talk about very different concerns or very different issues altogether, that they're full of discussion about oppression in Iran or the British post-colonial legacy and so forth. That these debates tend to be colonised or instrumentalised by politicians, used as a vehicle for airing other concerns and other ideas. And that leads me to my final question, really, which is something I'm not sure I have an answer to at the moment, which is, to what extent, in that case, do these debates about adding new organisations to the British list of banned groups constitute debates at all? Prescription decisions in the UK, at least, are a foregone conclusion. Every time the Home Secretary brings a group forward for banning, they get added to the list. Parliament ratifies it without exception. So in a sense, you could make an argument, I think, that there are no, the ostensible stakes of this political game are not there at all. It looks like a debate, but actually the decision's already been made.
groups are always added to the UK's list, and it's notoriously difficult to get yourself off of the list once you're already there. And yet at the same time, you do see within this particular forum lots of evidence of political and normative opposition of various sorts, just not in relation to the adding or not adding of these particular groups to the list. So there is politics within these debates, but I'm not sure whether these are debates about their ostensible focus, if that makes sense. And that's it. So thank you very much.
Lee, I've actually got a couple of questions straight away. So in the presentation, you showed a picture of Anjum Chowdhury.
Yeah.
And doesn't this show the weakness or the limitations of prescribing a group as a terrorist organisation? Because he was only convicted this year, yet Al-Mahajirun and then Sharia for UK were prescribed many, many years ago. So what impact did banning his organisations have on his activities?
Yeah, and in a sense, I agree quite a lot with you, I think, that as a form of counter-terrorism power, that prescriptions' value is perhaps a lot more limited than its advocates suggest, right? That decisions have to be made about which groups to add and which groups to not, and those decisions are made in the context of a fairly flexible definition of terrorism and a fairly flexible set of criteria. And so lots and lots of people from legal backgrounds have argued that actually what's going on in these contexts is not anything to do with counterterrorism at all, it's other motives or other interests intervene. So it's that contingency, it's that kind of the unpredictable nature of who or what gets added to lists at particular moments that I think makes it potentially problematic, but also politically interesting.
So in the example of Al-Mahajirun, what then happened to the members of that organisation once the organisation itself was banned?
Yeah, David Anderson's recent report, I don't know if you've seen it last week, which was his annual review of terrorism powers within the United Kingdom. He's got information in there about the number of times prescription powers have been used to convict people. And the numbers since the introduction of this power in 2000, the numbers are very, very low. Mm. And that feeds all sorts of criticisms that can't we be dealing with these organisations or these individuals in different ways? How do you definitively identify someone as a member of a banned organisation? All of those kind of problems that are potentially prominent within contemporary terrorist context, but arguably go back further.
Yeah. So you're saying it wasn't as effective as perhaps is perceived because the individuals, they still existed, they still associated with each other?
I think what's going on is not, in a sense, the effectiveness of prescription as a form of counterterrorism policy is perhaps the wrong question. I think that there are other things going on that are maybe more important than is this making us safer from terrorism.
Okay, brilliant. Thanks.
Thank you, Richard.
I don't know if that conclusion it almost seems like the point is to move on. No. thanks to Lee for really setting out a lot of the key issues I wanted to cover. But what I'd like to do is, first off, take prescription as a given. It's something governments are engaged in. It's something liberal democracies seem to be much more active in than anybody else. And it's something that's going to continue. It's going to keep moving on. But in terms of the themes of the conference, I was looking at a very specific exercise of trying to reconcile this process of prescription within a human rights framework. And I think there's some possibilities in it, and I think at the same time, I'm not sure it's a complete reconciliation. We can still argue the counterterrorism, the security overruns the human rights element to it. But at the same time, I feel the prescription process is something we can do to better situate our understandings of human rights in the current context. I know I'm going to come away from this seeming to be that I'm arguing for a really powerful police state and you bad, bad, bad person, no problem, easy to take on the criticisms. But at the same time, even though we talked about the effectiveness and it's highly questionable, if we did prescription correctly, if prescription could provide some of the benefits that we heard about, looking at how we go about the prescription process becomes the next important step in identifying possible threats. And we can use as a reference point, essentially, the human rights framework. So instead of just looking at the bad enemies we don't like, we have to come up with a much more, I'd say, almost normative position in determining who these organizations are and why we're gonna outlaw them, disrupt them, and essentially put them in the margins.
And in doing so, we can look to the international human rights regime. It grew up over the last 50 years in the context where it is felt that limitations can be placed on rights for the purposes of keeping the system intact. Now, I will, as a slight, just as a disclosure, I'm not a firm believer in the massive passing of more and more and more and more laws. In one of the previous events we have, I spoke about how we're seeing more and more legal constructions of terrorism, how this is not necessarily a good thing, how it actually causes more problems than it's worse. And I understand prescription to fall within the same sort of category. But equally, as Lee already talked about, and going back to David's talk this morning, prescription does seem to have at least a symbolic, if not potentially effective purpose in disrupting. No, it doesn't allow people to gather together. Yes, they can, as individuals, they can still do it, but they don't have that sort of core ability to organize, to act, to carry out their agendas. It does have that strong normative statement, what you're sort of pursuing, your political agenda is bad, it's wrong, we're not going to tolerate it here. And I know when the prescription thing kicked about in the current context, it was supposed to give rise to international cooperation. It certainly hasn't. I think some of your research and others have shown there's only like 14 groups that cross five or six lists. So it's not the best process in the world. But equally, it's quite an interesting process because it allows us to raise questions of what is acceptable in our societies and what is not from the human rights framework. Also, looking at this in the current context, and I will put it in a particular context that we're living in, it is within the Islamist context. Okay, I think that's an important element that I will obviously be referring to. It is this idea that groups and individuals want to bring about the Islamic State, the caliphate. Now, I know quite often working in the West, people just sort of shrug that off and say, that's not going to happen, so don't worry about it. But it is still a large motivator, and it's this idea that this a world order will be imposed upon us one way or the other. Okay, and it's something I think we need to be looking at objectives over the means to get a better understanding of what is actually going on. So in looking at these various groups, obviously, if you come from the human rights approach, say human rights much more important, the ability to participate in political processes, ability to assemble, to associate, absolutely. All of those human rights, though, in every single international legal instrument have restrictions on them. They are limited rights. They are not absolute. At the same time, if we come from the counterterrorism, countering violent extremism perspective, we put a lot of emphasis upon the state. The state has this obligation, this duty to protect us, to provide human security, and it must go do whatever it needs to do to get that done. We know the damages, we know the problems of states acting that way, and I'm certainly not encouraging that. And as we've heard from the talks this morning, we are looking at two different constructs in many ways. The human rights approach does rights first, freedom. Rights first, the restrictions on freedom second, counterterrorism approach is restrictions first, and we might worry about the rights later. No offense, Arturo, but you know, we might worry about the human rights later, even though they're integrated. but at the same time, I think we are looking to the state to provide a much stronger position. Now, international law generally, we do see prescriptions of terrorist organizations. Al-Qaeda is a threat to international peace and security. Every state must act to disrupt this behavior, criminalize economic activity in support of it, et cetera, et cetera. So this is not a sort of unique or uncommon issue. But within the domestic framework, I mean, as Lee's already pointed out, as you guys have discussed, it is quite political sometimes. It seems to be very selective, and that does raise some problems. But I think at the same time, if we do look upon the state to provide us with the opportunity to have our security, then we do need to be asking serious questions, not only how these organizations operate. Obviously, blowing things up, killing people are criminal acts. We have laws to deal with that stuff. Pursuing of objectives that are looking to destroy worldviews, to overcome civilizations, however you want to look at it, I think we need to start asking some questions about this. So in looking at this, I went back into some of the human rights work that I've been sort of dealing with and teaching on for a number of years. And one of the things that I always put out to people is that The human rights treaties all say nothing in this treaty allows for groups or individuals to destroy the rights of others. Now, these provisions are usually at the end of the treaty, so you think, oh, it was a complete throwaway, or you know, the janitor wrote it in after everybody left the room. No, but these are very serious statements that were put in on purpose in response to perceived and real threats to the society at the time. I mean, Article 30 of the Universal Declaration on Human Rights reads in full, nothing in this declaration may be interpreted as implying for any state, group, or person any right to engage in any activity or to perform any act aimed at the destruction of any of these rights. Now, for me, this just sort of makes sense. Human rights are exercised in a collective. We all have our individual rights, but we just cannot absolutely exercise our individual rights however we want to. We have to do it with each other. We have to be respectful. We have to accept each other's existence and each other's presence as a rights holder. Civil and political rights are very much social activities. It's something you engage in with others. You might do it in different ways, you might have different perspectives, but you do have to have the element of respect. Now, what's important to point out is that these sort of final clauses are not state of emergency matters. They are the ongoing situation within which the human rights framework exists. And when you look at the history of why was this drafted, why did they put this part in? Especially in naming states, groups, or persons. So obviously naming the state, that takes us back to the old argument, the state cannot argue security so important I have to impose upon your human rights, don't ask any questions. Individual persons dealing with, you know, me killing you, trying to deny you your rights, so we know that's a problem. But they particularly, with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the European Convention on Human Rights, they specifically talked about groups. Organized political groups that they felt would, the drafters felt, would purposely use the rights and freedoms set out in the new treaty or the new declaration to undermine the entire system. And again, states specifically spoke out about how we have experience in this and we know it might happen. Now, I know a typical response to all this saying, no, the European experience after World War II is so unique, it has no resonance anywhere else. I don't really buy that. It was a post-conflict situation. It was based on political circumstances that had to be addressed. Safeguards had to be in place. We can find similar circumstances today. In the drafting of the Universal Declaration, France laid this out quite clearly. Experience has shown that it's groups that will undertake activities under the guise of human rights, and they'll start to look to destroy the human rights system that we have. Similar things came from Belgium, pointing out it was a necessity to stop the activities of subversive groups that are trying to destroy our system. And a number of other states continually talked about how Article 30 now, but at the time it was Article 28, was indispensable to the overall framework. The European Convention had the same situation. What I always find interesting in the European Convention system is you never find a human right to democracy, and the right to free election is put in a separate treaty. The debate on this is quite interesting. The drafters of the European Convention did not want the right to free elections in it. They certainly did not want any human right to democracy because they were afraid this would be manipulated by what they considered subversive groups to destroy the systems they were trying to build. So it was a limitation of rights to protect human rights, which I know is a slippery slope. It's a very dangerous argument. But it is also something that is in practice in response to specific historical social conditions and a necessity. Article 17 has the same wording as Article 30 of the European Convention, but with the European Convention on Human Rights, we can also find some jurisprudence from the European Commission and the European Court. This is important because obviously commissions and courts are seen as very pro-human rights. They're not that concerned with the state and security, even though that's changing these days as well. But in an early cases, in dealing with prohibitions on the right to political participation, the commission made it very clear that certain groups may be disqualified from political participation due to their overall objectives and ideologies. In the mid-70s, in a case involving the Netherlands, the court upheld an absolute prohibition on political participation for what the court then called uncitizen-like behavior. I know that has all kinds of connotations that's disturbing, But the court's reasoning was these individuals are using the system in their desire to destroy the system, and we're not going to have that. More recently, involving Turkey, where you had the government, classic example, everybody's illegal, prescribed all kinds of political parties. A lot of these cases went to the European Court of Human Rights, and you see an interesting balance. Situations where the party in question was looking to shift the Constitution, change the Constitution, bring about changes in the Constitution through nonviolent means, their prohibition, their banning, their prescription was deemed to be a violation of articles in the European Convention. However, there are a couple of cases, in particular the REFA party, where they went into great depth to look at the objectives of this party. The objectives of this party were quite clear. The Turkish Constitution has to go, a complete system of Sharia law must be implemented, and we will use both nonviolent and violent means to do this. Now, the party tried to say, no, no, that's some guy said that. We've never said that. It's not in our official documentation. But the government put forth the arguments, and the courts did their own investigation, and they said these plans are all part of the party objective. These plans do not seek to work within the system. Their only objective is to destroy the system. So therefore, their prescription, their banning, their exclusion was seen as legitimate in a democratic society under the European Convention of Human Rights. Going forward, the European Convention is changing in many respects, in that it's placing a greater obligation upon the state to provide security, the positive obligations. We heard about this morning. They seem to be upping their scrutiny and allowing for more and more government measures in relation to trying to provide the security part. And I think there are some question marks to be asked there. But in the process of prescription, I do believe that we can show, if governments can show, that these organizations are going to use the system of human rights to essentially get rid of that system and bring their own system in place to be imposed through a combination of violence and nonviolence. Then their prescription would be justified. And this is not a victory for the counterterrorism part of it. I see it as more of a victory for the human security side of it. I would still remain very skeptical of the government arguments. I mean, as you point out with the parliamentary debates, and they just seem to approve things, ask questions, look at what they're doing. And as I said, what I find intriguing, the numbers Lee already brought up, is that it's liberal democracies based on human rights frameworks that are making the most out of the prescription element. And if you look at the grounds for prescription, the threat to the overall system is always one of them. And you gotta start asking some serious question marks as to why is it liberal democracies feel more threatened? I'm not sure if they should be, or are they just making use of the idea that they have a system that is to be valued? Threats to that system are problematic. Now, you know, in looking at this, we are getting into issues of ideology, we're getting into issues of political choices, but I think there is enough evidence, there is enough research, there is enough smarts out there, I hate to say that for governments, I think they are smart enough, to be looking at objectives closely, asking tough questions of these organizations, and coming to determinations if they are a threat to the overall system. And so that respect, potentially, certainly at the state we're at now, it's not. The process of prescription could be a relatively useful tool in trying to get international cooperation and countering violent extremism and terrorism and help to support some of the aspects of human security that we're pursuing. And I'll leave it there.
Okay, thank you. So, just before I throw it out to the audience, the counter argument to saying that prescription is a useful tool that we should encourage is that by prescribing groups that work within the system against the system, you're essentially compromising the same values that you seek to uphold. So what is the counter to that counter argument?
Well, that's the problem. You do get these circular arguments where by limiting political rights, by limiting association rights, by limiting even expression rights, you're just as bad as they are. But then this becomes the question mark. Where does our security and where do our rights emanate from? I know we have these ideas that we're all individual human beings and we have these natural rights, but we live in administrative legal systems. Mm. We live in societal constructions.
So there are some organizing rules to the game. Everybody can come to the game, they can participate in it, but they have to recognize that the core rules of the game, the structures within which we exist, are firm. They are here for everybody. So they cannot be used and manipulated by one group of persons, one group in society, to remove that system and impose it with their own system. So as we go back to, as I said, the debates about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, this is how it was worded, that people are going to use this system to get rid of our system. Mm. Now, people can use it to manipulate it to further their own ideas, but they keep the system in place.
Okay.
But it's those whose objectives, and that's why I'm saying we need to start looking at some of the objectives. If the objective is to get rid of the system, the question then becomes, how can you benefit? How should you be able to benefit from it?
Okay. Just to change tack a little bit, you both spoke on how prescribing organizations are actually a chance for cooperation and consensus. But couldn't this actually, due to the political nature of prescribing organizations, come back to bite people in their ass? Because you see with the US support for Kurdish groups in Syria, that they're actually working with sister organizations of prescribed groups like the PKK. So how could we then reconcile? Isn't that they're tripping up over their own devices?
Sure, and this is an argument that gets made a lot, that prescription decisions are basically a chip in other geopolitical games, right? That PMOI is an example that's used quite frequently, which was an organization that lots of critics argue the United Kingdom banned, prescribed, in order to gain concessions on the Iranian nuclear power program, right? And the argument there is that actually what's going on is very often got nothing to do with terrorism or counterterrorism at all. This is just used as a kind of bargaining chip in other debates. It's interesting, I think, that there is so little overlap in terms of the different groups that are on the list of quite staunch allies within, say, the contemporary counterterrorism context as well, as you just pointed. And you might expect more overlap between the UK's list and the US list and others as well.
Yeah. And it's going back to the sanctions regime that does exist on Al-Qaeda and other groups. This is a... It is a Section 7, yeah?
1267 and 1988.
And it is mandatory powers, it's Chapter 7. All states it's supposed to apply to, and one of the key issues in every resolution is cooperation amongst authorities, but yet they still won't quite do it.
Sure.
But that's the nature of international law, that's the nature of international politics, and you're right, when it comes to this sort of issue, we see varying things. So it's local political interests. If you have groups that have influence over government, they'll show all those guys, they're bad, and governments will listen to them. Then the UK's prescription process is about international cooperation, so you don't know who's influencing or who's not influencing them. But the potential still could be there. I mean, just to throw a number out, mainly because my colleague would be interested in this, Canada has prescribed 54. The US has only prescribed 60. I didn't realize that, Canada's not the same geopolitical actor, but it seems to be under finding just as many threats as the US, or it's looking to cooperate with them. But it's interesting how some states are using this for potentially cooperation or self-interest. And I think it's one of those things we'll continually struggle to get through, but I think what we need to do is keep talking about it. Because the one thing I found, correct me if I'm wrong, Israel does not prescribe Al-Qaeda as a terrorist organization in their domestic law.
Why do you think that is?
I think they just accept the Security Council resolution, call it good. Okay. But like China only prescribes 5. And they're all from the central republics.
Sure.
And so they're very much related to their security interests. They don't prescribe anybody else.
Okay. So has anyone got any comments or questions about prescribing or banning of terrorist groups?
Thank you very much. That was a really interesting presentation. I had a question that actually I think fits for both of you, and Arturo, correct me if I'm wrong. But I found it really interesting that some of these prescription regimes make some factual shortcuts. So, for example, Jabhat al-Nusra, Al-Qaeda in Iraq, IS and Daesh in the UN reports and UN all come together as if they're all really fighting together, when in fact we know that they're all broken up and fighting each other. But somehow, for the sanctions regime, it is more in the interest to present them as unified actors or similar actors rather than as different actors. And there seems to be a habit, I don't want to say a habit, but at least some cases where people are playing fast and loose with facts to serve the purpose of prescribing and imposing certain legal sanctions.
Okay. Any responses to that?
Yeah, the factual shortcuts, as we know, is just huge.
Yeah, but we have both two main, the 1267 committee and the 1988, and actually the 1267 just recently, I think this year, there's a resolution 2253 which included ISIL as an associate, unassociated groups to ISIL. I would like to bring it all to a human rights approach. One of the committees has an office of the ombudsman for a delisting process. Probably it's not enough, but it's there and it's being used, because the mechanism for listing, you don't have to go through a judicial process, as you know. So there's a delisting process. The other committee, funnily enough or interestingly enough, does not have the same regime for available to, and this one is for both individuals and groups, to challenge the decision. And the implications are serious, because the three main components are arms embargoes, freezing of assets, and others. So as an individual that makes it to the list, and then having all your assets frozen. So this is at the international level, obviously, as Richard is mentioning. The idea is in the spirit of collaboration, and if Canada has almost as so many as the U.S., the idea would be at every member state taking action on at least what has been agreed by the international community. We can go back to that discussion, but of who's making it to the list. Via the committee, the sanctions committee. So my comment would only be, if in the UK there is a similar process to from a human rights perspective, or what is there available, taking into account that you mentioned that it's possible, although probably very lengthy and difficult, to make it off the list.
It is possible. It's notoriously difficult. It's happened very, very rarely. Partly because you have to make, as a banned organisation, you have to try to take that process yourself. And if you don't exist as an organisation within the United Kingdom, under what circumstances can you begin that process of appealing to the Home Secretary and taking it further? So it has happened, and the PMOI is the example that's usually used, but it's very, very unusual and very, very difficult and lengthy. The fast and loose point is really important, though, particularly because, at least in the UK, Parliament bans multiple groups at the same time. So they've got to make a decision on whether to ban all of these organisations or none of them, so whether to accept the order or to reject it. And politicians are frequently very, very explicit. In Parliament, they'll say, I've never heard of this group, but I'm going to support you anyway. I trust you, and I don't have access to the intelligence you have. We're going to support you, but I don't know who we're banning or why.
And that same thing happens at the international level. States send their list to the Security Council. Security Council doesn't check the facts, sets them on their list. The EU just imports the UN list, doesn't even begin to ask any questions of it. Then it feeds back down to the member states. They start, oh, well, that person's not on my list, I'll add it to it. And this is a key issue we always have when it comes to information about extremist organizations. It's confidential. We don't want to reveal too much. We'll give up our intelligence. Mm. And so politicians will just say, yeah, if they're on the list, they must be bad. So yeah, the fast and loose facts is a real issue.
Absolutely. So speaking in the context of Europe and the UK, is there a risk then banning these groups that you reduce the potential for surveillance measures on them?
It's an argument that's made a lot. Not only that, because you potentially drive them underground or you stop them operating in the United Kingdom, but also you make it much more difficult for them to engage in peace processes.
Yeah.
Right? And the lesson is often drawn from Northern Ireland example that we've spoken about a lot.
Do you find it a convincing argument, Lee?
I think, in a sense, it's the wrong grounds to have the discussion on, because it comes back to that question of effectiveness, and I think there are other questions that we might be asking. Basically, under what circumstances does prescription seem to be a feasible way of countering terrorism, rather than necessarily does prescription work or not?
Okay. Yep, yourself? And then we'll come to yourself there.
I'm not sure it's a question or just sort of looking for insight. I was thinking Hezbollah and Hamas, whose military wings are proscribed but not their political wings, which is similar to the PIRA and Sinn Féin. Why does that happen in terms of, is it just they're too important to fully proscribe, whereas a small organisation that's part of the resistance or what have you in Syria are not important enough, so you just ban the whole thing, you don't have to have that nuance? Just an insight into how that decision is made.
Okay. Could we take a couple more questions and then we'll come back to the panel? Yeah, just behind you.
Sure. Can you say more about the ritualistic function of prescription? And if it is a ritual, what kind is it? Is it a shaming ritual or ritual of degradation? Something like that.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, I wonder if it's worth separating out prescription in the domestic versus the international context. So your last example about negotiating, it's one thing to negotiate and to surface groups within your country versus outside, and there are also different levels of prescription. So, I mean, growing up in the United States in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, we had a list of prescribed organizations, but the organizations were only prescribed in terms of you knew if you belonged to them that there would be punishments in the sense of not legal punishments, not in terms of, you know, you're going to jail, but you might not get a job, you might not get security clearance, you might not be able to work in certain industries. But that's so it had the effect, but it wasn't the organizations themselves weren't banned. Shaming as a tool. It was, so I think that it is important to distinguish between those two, and also the distinguishing factor in the U.S. at least, and I don't know how Canada adds names to the list, but in the U.S. it's simply the Department of State on the international level. It is not an act of Congress. It is not in legislation. It has the power of the executive.
Okay. So three questions on Hezbollah and other groups, the political and other side. We've got the ritualistic aspect of banning.
I mean, the Hezbollah and Hamas is an interesting example on both the efficacy and places where things could be done to, I think, better enhance these processes. The core idea there is that if the political wing does not use violence and they publicly renounce violence, then they're not a terrorist organization. The groups that still use violence are. However, question marks are then asked about what I spoke of. Well, what's their overall objective? If the political wing is seeking essentially a violent outcome, change in the structure, then why aren't they considered terrorists as well? And I think it is directly tied to how can we negotiate? How can we talk to the Jews? We can't talk to terrorists as it is. So let's have the political wing so we can talk to, and let's condemn the other guys, even though we all know the money's going back and forth and back and forth. And I don't think, I'm on the international scale and looking at some of these groups, especially like Hamas, I don't see how you can negotiate with the political wing at all, because their worldview is just completely different. They won't even sit at the table with you. I mean, they said, no, we're going to do it our way and we're done here type thing. Michael, I think you're absolutely right. We do need to sort of differentiate how the international and the domestic should be done. And perhaps by doing it that way, you might actually see more effective cooperation on the international scale. But equally, right now, they seem to be too intertwined that you can't really separate them out in any way. And it does create problems along the way. And I'll leave ritualization to.
Yeah, so to just add, firstly, in response to Michael's question, I think, yeah, it's a really interesting question. And it's important to think about those nuances in terms of what gets banned and how different kinds of banning work in different times, different places. And one of the things we're trying to do on the project is to map this globally and to look at what organisations get added to what countries' lists at different times to try and trace those connections. And so I don't have an answer, but I think it's a really important distinction. In terms of the ritualistic aspect of prescription, the argument we make in the paper is that if you think about any kinds of rituals, whether it's graduation ceremonies or bar mitzvahs or cup finals or whatever, you get a standard set of things taking place. You get particular actors performing particular roles in designated times and designated places, moving forward towards an anticipated knowable outcome.
And it's exactly the same we argue in terms of these parliamentary debates, that they are always introduced by the same person who uses almost identical words each time new groups are added to the list. You get the same kind of questions being asked by parliamentarians every time, and you get a process working through towards this almost inevitable outcome, which is, oh yeah, we're adding these groups to the list. And the argument there is basically that it's a ritualistic performance. The argument we make is it's a ritualistic performance of sovereignty in one sense. It's sovereign power being very explicitly exercised. We're banning you from our territory, but also of democracy as well, that it is ostensibly a space of debate, contestation, even if the political stakes might be different.
So. Okay. Any other comments or questions from the audience? Yep, over here at the front.
Thank you. Another aspect of the discussion that I found there was sort of a blurred line between the two ways you both approached it was between sort of your focus on jihadist and terrorist groups and your look towards sort of Islamist groups that might undermine democratic principles or constitutions and so forth. So I was wondering if you could clarify a little bit where you draw those lines, especially the case of Egypt was drawn to my mind where you're talking with the Muslim Brotherhood and the kind of debates that's produced. Is it realistic for us to advocate banning groups if they're only softly Islamizing a country, if they're only somewhat undermining constitutions? Where do we draw that line?
Yeah, I mean, I think I was speaking more of, when I say the Islamist organization, the jihadist ones, the ones that are seeking to bring about the caliphate. And this is not a soft line, this is not a vague line, this is not an obscure line, it's a clear line. The objective is we are going to engage in this activity to get there, either violent or nonviolent. In my mind, I don't see how groups, and it's not just groups like that, you can see it in white supremacy groups, they want to get rid of the whole system to ensure they have the power. I don't see how they can benefit from the safeguards and security of the system in that respect. Now, if we're talking about organizations that are merely seeking to raise awareness of certain religious dimensions in society, be it Islam, be it Christianity, be it Judaism, I mean, yeah, they're working within the system. They're staying, they respect the system. They're staying within the values of the system. So no, you can't be banning those, even though there is a tendency, again, to go back to the earlier point, let's not do any fact-checking. Let's just quickly say, yeah, we know they're bad because we don't like them. I mean, the Muslim Brotherhood is a good example, and it is a real tension for states in the Gulf because banned terrorist organization in most of the GCC states, banned terrorist organization in Russia, banned terrorist organization in a couple other places outside GC, I can't remember now. But yet, with varying degrees of recognition in Europe. And this goes back to the international cooperation element, the question being asked, this organization is seeking to bring about the caliphate quite clearly. It's not an old, obscure notion. In the 1990s, early 2000s, senior officials in the organization were saying, we're going to do this one way or the other. But yet you allow them to be a legitimate political party. Now, I think a lot of that is down to ignorance. A lot of it is down to we need somebody to talk to. But this is an area where potentially we should see some global cooperation, listening to people who have been most affected by it. I mean, because obviously if we're going to raise the caliphate, it's going to have to happen in the Middle East and the Gulf region first. I mean, you're not going to raise it in Paris or London and then try to take it to the Middle East. You're going to go in the Middle East and try to raise it there. So it's an important issue because you do see organizations working, furthering their cause that has global impact. And this is an area where cooperation should come about. But yeah, I think you're right. It's a good question to ask. Where do we draw lines? We have to draw a clear line, the use of violence to essentially overthrow the system, denial of the system. These are areas where we can draw the line.
I guess just to add to that, perhaps, I'm not particularly interested in trying to draw that line myself. I'm more interested in how that line is drawn by other kinds of actors, by politicians and so forth. A little while ago, I interviewed Charles Clarke, former Home Secretary, and asked him a little bit about prescription. And he was responsible, in the UK at least, for putting in place, or in part responsible for putting in place the system at the moment, which is that parliamentarians are given a little fact sheet when they come to these debates about the organisations that they're thinking about adding to the list. And that fact sheet is based purely on open source information because you can't put sensitive information in that context, because otherwise it becomes public.
Just before we break for some coffee, we've got time for a quick final question, if anyone has one. Yes.
Prescription perhaps leads me to think about literature, because in a way, if you prescribe an organization, its ideas can also be disseminated through literature. And that's, what do we do about prescribing literature of these organizations?
Okay. Any comments on that one?
Well, again, I think it's a competition for ideas. There's no question there. But going back to the earlier question, we can draw lines on, you know, if we're going too far, if it seems, if the whole purpose is to get rid of the system that within which you're enjoying the benefits, then you can draw the line. I mean, literature is something a bit more sensitive, I guess we'd argue. It passively sits there. But these prescribed organizations, they are acting in an active manner. And there's a distinction there to be considering.
Yeah, I guess in the UK, it comes in under the glorification of terrorism offence that was added more recently, that you can be, the prescription can come into power in the case of individuals that are glorifying terrorists.
Because I remember in the sort of, late 1990s, the Swiss authorities, I believe, the French, they banned some Islamic literatures, prescribed them, simply because the literature was actually advocating violent overthrow of democracy.
But I mean, Germany still has bans on certain amounts of literature. And so there's a specific reason behind it, I realize that, but it's a reason relative to their system.
But I think also the Muslim Brotherhood issue is a bit more complicated, simply because its benefactors in the past, in fact, or rather, I should do, its promoters in the past were the very states which are now attempting to isolate Muslim Brotherhood. And it was given a huge amount of resources and actually respectability. Their academics were allowed to fly first class all over the world. It's just recently, I think, that prohibition is beginning to take effect. So, okay. So I think this is a moving.
Sure, it's a moving debate. Absolutely. So what we'll do now is we'll take a coffee break, which will last about half an hour, and then we'll have the final session of today, which will be looking at humanitarian intervention and foreign policy. But before we leave, I'd like to say thank you to Liam Richard.
Thank you.